This is the Thoughtful Travel Podcast. I'm your host, Amanda Kendall of the notaballerina.com travel blog. Every episode, I'll share travel tales from several fellow travel lovers, and together we hope to entertain and inspire you, remind you of some of your own great travel experiences, and encourage you to hit the road again soon. Hello and welcome to episode 248 of the Thoughtful Travel Podcast. This episode is about studying in other countries. It's something I've never done, sadly, but I do teach at university here. I just teach one unit every semester, so one or two classes usually. And I'm always excited when I have international students in my class. It's quite a big industry in Australia to have students from abroad, whether they're there on exchange or they've come to take their whole degree here. And we have, you know, especially from various parts of Asia, we have lots of students here. But yeah, I have in the last 12 months because none have been arriving thanks to the pandemic, but over recent years I've had students from all kinds of far-flung corners, and when they do their assessments and talk about their own backgrounds, I just love it. I had one from the Maldives recently, which was really interesting to hear. It's quite different to hear from the usual, you know, kind of tourism in the Maldives perspective, all sorts of stuff. And I always think, wow, this experience is so life-changing for them, and I'm glad I can be a tiny part of it. In fact, actually, we made an episode about this a few months back. It was episode 233, so we heard some tales of studying abroad now, but I think since it's one of the most wonderful ways to travel, you know, studying in other countries, it's a great reason to spend an extended time abroad. So I've actually collected another set of stories from people who have studied in countries other than their home countries. So, and I might have missed my chance to do this as a teenager, but one day, I haven't discounted that I might do it someday, sometime. I won't be a teenager. I can't fix that, but who knows? Anyway, my first guest today is Caitlin Jane, and it was exciting to talk to Caitlin because she had actually had a study abroad experience here in Australia.
So, before I studied abroad, I had never really left the country. I had gone to Mexico with my parents because I'm in the U.S., and I'd gone to Canada because we lived just across the bridge from Canada, but I'd never left North America. And so since I had very limited language skills, I decided to go to Australia. And my parents had actually lived in Australia. My dad played professional basketball in Melbourne, so they had some friends in Melbourne. And so, and I'm sure I'm pronouncing it wrong. I'm sorry.
You're pretty close, actually. Yep. I'll pass that.
All right. So my dad and my mom had lived there for about a year. They had my brother there. And so it was just a great place that I wanted to visit. So I spent a semester studying at UQ, the University of Queensland in Brisbane. And it was just a phenomenal experience for me. And it really opened my eyes to travel and that I wanted to do more of it. When I studied there, I immediately got in real close with a group of Aussies. And so I had this group that I was with all the time. So I had an American roommate and a bunch of guys. That was my for the time that I was there. And by having that experience, I was able to experience the culture more than a lot of my other American classmates. And I was exposed to things that I wouldn't have been otherwise. So I joined a local netball team.
Netball is not familiar to you, right? You don't usually play netball in the States. I thought so. Yeah. Oh, awesome. I love netball.
So I played basketball in high school. And so I was pretty good at basketball. And so playing netball in Australia, it was like a throwback because it's just very, very different, but it was so much fun.
That's so cool.
And I loved it there, and it was just a great experience to learn your culture, especially being integrated, going to all your barbecues and, you know, all the parties. And it was so much fun. And I think that any American would have fun studying in Australia, but having that group of friends and staying close to that group of friends over the years, you know, because you guys love travel. And
yeah,
I've had so many visitors from Australia that come and they want to come watch the NCAA basketball tournament, or they want to go watch whatever sport is going on here. You guys love your sports too.
That's true.
I've had so many guests, and, you know, just having that experience was just an amazing thing. And I really advocate for people to study abroad, especially if you have not traveled much, because you do get a completely different experience and get that immersion for 6 months. So
yeah, absolutely.
I absolutely loved it. And I think it was also beneficial to my friends there, because many of them didn't have that really close relationship with Americans first off. And so they learned that we are not just like all Beverly Hills or, you know, New York City. I'm from the Midwest. And so it's just a very different experience. And then also I made them become tourists of their own country. And so when I was there, I was like, I really want to go see Uluru. And they're like, oh, that's too far. And I said, well, I'm an American. This is like what we do, is we make things happen. And so we found a rental company for the car and we just drove to Uluru, and it was a 3-day trip, and it was so much fun.
That is very cool.
and I know a lot of Australians haven't seen it. But when you're a tourist, you visit those places, and I dragged three of my friends along with me. So it was just an amazing experience. And I really, really advocate to study abroad.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm always telling my son that that's what he will do when he's studying. So I love that you got them to go to Uluru, because I have been, but I know heaps and heaps of Aussies who haven't, because it is kind of in the middle of nowhere and quite far from everywhere. But it's pretty spectacular,
isn't it?
And it's
super expensive.
Yes.
It's so expensive. And the dollar was very strong when I studied there, but my friends couldn't afford to fly there. And so I was like, let's rent a car, you know?
That would have been awesome. Road trip.
Yes. And having a road trip and seeing kangaroos by the side of the road, and there's no speed limit in parts of Australia. And it was just absolutely crazy just seeing that part of the world.
Yeah, because it's very special and different, and it's so very, very empty for so very, very far, isn't it? It's
so
hard to imagine.
Empty.
Yeah.
Yes. And then actually a funny story is when we were on that trip, we were at some pub in the middle of nowhere, and they had a famous cricket player there, Ian Healy.
Oh,
and
yeah.
The guys were just so excited, and I was like, who's this guy? They all got their pictures, they all got his autograph, and it was just the highlight of, you know, their year is meeting Ian Healy, their cricket, you know,
hero.
Idol. So, yeah.
And you're like, I really don't understand cricket.
Yeah. And we're like 2 days away from civilization. So it was very cool.
That is pretty amazing. How funny. What made you decide that you wanted to study abroad? Like, it's a big leap. Why did you really think, okay, I really want to do that?
So my college really encouraged study abroad, and I played a sport in college. But even though I played a sport, they still encouraged us to study abroad. And that's one of the reasons that I chose the school that I went to. So I had to go in our spring semester because of my sport. That's why I had to go when I went. But I really wanted to experience something new, and I'm open to new experiences and just trying new things. And another cool thing about studying in Australia is that, you know, first off, I got to see where my parents had lived and, you know, see a new place. And there's so many wonderful things about Australia. But then also I went to New Zealand for my break because, again, the dollar was very strong when I visited. Mm. And so I was able to go to New Zealand and see that for a week. So
brilliant.
Really, really amazing.
Yeah. Oh, wow. I really think Caitlin became basically an honorary Aussie during her time here. She got to know who famous cricketers were. She played netball. She went to Uluru. You know, top marks, Caitlin. I'm very impressed by your total immersion in Australia. And it sounds like so much fun and really, really worth doing. Now, my next guest today is Helena Fox, and she actually describes her studying experience in the US as running away from Australia, which I think is a, you know, it's a great thing to do sometimes.
So what I had done was I'd gotten the marks to get into law school, and like the people who think they have to do something because they've got the marks, I can very much relate to those people.
Yeah.
I thought, oh, I could just do an arts degree, quote unquote, but I should do the law degree because I got the marks, and so
yes.
I should push myself. And please, if you are a young person and you are thinking you should do anything, A, don't feel that you should, because don't do it if that's the only reason. I'm now going to give life lessons to the youth.
It's okay, because I completely agree with these life lessons, so continue.
And then also, don't do law if you don't actually care about a law degree. Like, I've actually seen people say, unless you're going to be a lawyer, why would you do law? So I did that. I got into my law degree and I did the whole law degree, because there were times that I fled and I left and I went to America, traveled for almost a year, and then thought, no, I really should finish this law degree. Should. I don't know who I was actually listening to at that point. So I came home and I finished the law degree, and then I was doing, and then I backpacked around while I waited to get into College of Law, because so many people were funneling through this one system, which is everybody with their law degrees had to go and do College of Law, where you learnt to write a will or do a conveyancing, right. All the practical letter writing stuff that you, when you're at law school, you're like statutes and, you know, acts. And la da 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 da, but you don't learn how to write a legal letter till you're there. So I'd gone away to Europe. I'd come back, and I was in. I was starting to do College of Law, and I was heading towards being a family lawyer, because I really believed I wanted to work for children as a representative for them in custody cases. I wanted them to have a voice. So here we are now. I'm a writer who works, you know, who has written a book for young adults. So it doesn't surprise me that these things are connected. And I discovered that one of my dear friends from uni had actually passed away while I was backpacking through Europe. And I missed her funeral and missed everything. And she and I used to have these long chats. She was doing a medical degree, and she was an avid photographer and artist. And I remember her saying, when I'm done with my medical degree, I'm going to take time off and I'm going to do photography and art. And she was backpacking and she got sick and was flown home and she passed away. And she and I would talk, because my secret that I had been keeping since I was a little girl was that I wanted to be a writer. And I hadn't told anyone because the dream was so precious and it was so filled with potential for failure that I just didn't share that dream with many people. And I had already been published as a high school student. I'd been keeping a journal since I was a little girl. I had been reading voraciously and writing stories, but I didn't express that desire to be a writer. And I look back and go, why didn't I? And I think it was just so precious to me that the idea of sharing it and then having it not work out just felt too personal.
Or the reactions that people would have perhaps exactly. as well. Yeah.
So there was this moment where I think grief had a big effect on me. It was, I don't want to waste another minute. I can't do this. And at the same time, there was in fact a boy in the US, and he was like, why don't you just come over here? And I was like, why don't I? And so there was this moment where I just dropped out of College of Law. And so off I went, and I actually flew out. It was September 11, 2014 when I arrived in the US, and I enrolled in these evening classes at University of Washington, and those were my first ever writing classes.
Oh, wow. Right. Yes. Oh, my goodness.
And I lived with the boy. We didn't last super long. We only lasted a couple of years, sadly.
But it was important. It was enough to get you there.
Yeah, and he's now a very dear friend, so all is not lost.
Right.
And so, yeah, and then I got into an MFA program, and that's when everything kind of changed for me, when I actually articulated. I remember saying to my mum, who had no idea that I was interested in being a writer, I said, I want to be a writer. I want to leave College of Law. And I remember her saying to me, but why, in her surprise, said, but how can you be a writer? You've never kept a journal. And I thought, how can you not know? So I went to I was living with her at the time. I was in my early 20s, and I came out with my stack of journals that I'd been keeping since I was 13 years old. And I was crying. And I was this dream is important to me, you know. And she immediately was on my side. Yes.
She just had no idea. Yeah, you literally kept it. Wow.
I really flabbergasted everyone. And off I went. And I think if I hadn't run away, so to speak, to America, I think I would have lost my nerve.
Do you think you couldn't have done it staying in Australia? Do you think you had to be away from everything?
Yeah. Mm. I had to be away from everything that was my old world, because all my friends had law degrees. They were off to be successes, you know, they were off to do the normal thing. And I love adventures too. I loved getting on that plane and heading off and not knowing what was going to happen.
A fresh start, especially in another country, and when you've got something to study and keep your mind busy for a while, is often a very life-changing thing. Helena went on to tell me more about some of the travels she did in the US during her time there. And I got pretty jealous. Basically, that's my summary. Now, my final guest today is Annie Daly, who studied American Studies in college and left America to do it.
So I spent my entire junior year in college in England, which actually to me meant Europe in general, because one of the lovely things that I learned about taking classes in England is that I probably shouldn't be saying this, but that they don't really care that much about attendance. And as long as you pass the final exam at the end, like, you pass the class. And so my friends and I kind of took a lot of liberty with that and traveled a lot during our junior year abroad. And I
think that's a great idea. I fully support
the world. Me too. And the world was my teacher, as we like to say. And exactly. Of course I went to class, but there were, you know, there were a lot of 3-day weekends and those types of things where I was just so fortunate to be able to travel all around Europe. And I have a group of 5 best girlfriends from college, and we were all in different places in Europe. And so it was just constant visiting each other the whole time. And even though I was 21 and I am 36 now, that year was so formative to me. And I think about it still all the time for so many reasons. One of the main reasons I think about it is that this was before social media. This was right at the cusp of when Facebook started.
Yeah.
And I remember, like, during the last month of my year in England, I posted one photo from the entire year of me in London, like in the fountain in Trafalgar Square.
Cool.
And it was like the one photo for my entire college experience. And it's just so wonderful to think back on those travels, how we did it without social media.
Mm-hmm.
And I really try to capture that spirit now when I travel. And I'm not big on social media when I travel. I tend to do a lot of later grams when I come home, just because I think that having that really, really formative year without social media kind of set me up to travel in that way, to just be so in the moment and talking to people that I meet along the way and not necessarily documenting it because I haven't had the time to reflect on it yet.
Yes, you know? Exactly. Yeah, that's right. Yeah, I often find that. And that whole, you know, I mean, it's cliche to say living in the moment, but it really makes a difference when you're traveling, because then later on you've got so much more to say than if you are, you know, posting on social media then and there.
Exactly. And another reason that I loved my study abroad is that I was an American studies major in college, which I'm not even sure if they... Well, if people listening to this,
I'm not even sure what American Studies would be. No, so, tell me more.
Okay, so what American Studies is it's basically like the foundation, I think, of a lot of my travel writing and the book that I wrote, and that it's sort of a study of American culture, but actually mostly it's a study of how American culture is perceived around the world and how other countries view America. So the whole idea is that you can get to know your country better by looking at it from an outside perspective.
Right. And yeah. Interesting. Wow.
Yeah. It was a really cool major. And to me, that's what that study abroad year was all about, is I just think that it is so important at some point in life to go spend an extended amount of time outside of your home country, because that really truly is the only way to get that outside perspective on it. And I still, like, even though I still travel so much for my job now, I haven't lived in another country, and by lived, I think there was you did an episode about this earlier, actually, about like the definition of like what
we had
it
a discussion about
abroad.
This.
It was,
yeah,
like,
1 year
or something.
We decided 1 year. Yeah.
Well, I
it's completely arbitrary, but
like,
yeah.
Yeah, because it's like I've done month-long stints here and there where I'll go just like be a digital nomad in a place for a little bit, you know. But it's not the same as just being gone for an extended amount of time and looking at your home country through that outside lens. And to me, studying abroad is just such a gift, and anybody who even remotely has the opportunity to do it through their university or college or whatever, I just can't encourage it more, because what better way to get to know yourself, especially during those formative years of your early 20s and your late teens? Like that's when to do it.
It's the perfect time and the perfect way, isn't it? Because you have a bit of support, because, you know, your college or university, you know, helps, you know, there's some scaffolding for how to get there and where to go and what to do and where to live and stuff. But then you're also quite independent and you're at such an important age. So, yeah.
Yep.
Brilliant. Did you always know you wanted to study abroad, or did it just kind of happen once you were in college, or?
No, I always knew.
Right.
I actually didn't grow up traveling all that much. My parents really, we went to California. I grew up in Rhode Island on the East Coast, and we went to California a lot because my mom grew up there. So that was a lot of family travel, but I always had this innate wanderlust from an early age. And I can't explain it, but it hit me, like, I think even harder than other members of my family. Like, I've just always had a curiosity about the world. And so one of the reasons that I chose my college, I went to Dickinson College in Pennsylvania. It's a small liberal arts school. Uh-huh. And I chose them actually because they have a massive, massive emphasis on study abroad programming.
Right.
They send like 70% of their student body abroad, and they really encourage it. They make it so easy for you. They set it up so that it's like sort of just woven naturally into your curriculum. And one of my older brother's friends went there, and I remember she came back. She did her study abroad in India, and she came back and was like talking about her Indian study abroad experience at this college. And I was like, oh my gosh, I need to go there. That sounds amazing. And at the time I was like, I want to go to India. And I didn't end up going, although I did marry an Indian man. So now I go to India all the time.
I was going to say, I remember this from your book. You have plenty of India experience. So did you specifically choose England for any reason, or it was kind of what was available, or how did that happen?
Well, that was kind of my college's doing. Because I was an American studies major, they have centers all around Europe for your particular major. And so they have an American Studies Center in England, where we were actually directly enrolled in a university that specializes in American Studies, which was really cool, because you had Americans coming over to learn about American Studies in England, but then you also had a lot of British students learning about American Studies as British students. And so it created a cool conversation and dynamic in that way, because we were kind of able, because a lot of them did their study abroad in the U.S.,
course, right. Yeah.
And so we had a lot of nice dialogue there, and it was great.
That's a perfect setup. Yeah. Okay, that makes sense then, that you would choose, well, be sent to that particular university for that reason. That's very cool, because for the British students there to have then American study abroad students to be able to, I mean, that's real life American studies, isn't it? So yeah.
Annie and I actually went on to discuss more about Dickinson, and as a college, they really do pay a lot of attention to encouraging their students to study abroad. I mean, 70%, that's incredible. And this is definitely not sponsored or advertising, but I went to look at their website because I was kind of impressed with the idea. And I wondered, is it still the case that they are pushing this during the pandemic? And they're really set up, like, they're talking about going abroad for a semester or a year, or even to two or three different places. And I liked what they said. They said, we don't only make study abroad accessible, we make it life-changing. In fact, we ask students to have the courage to challenge their worldview, which I think all good education should do, of course, but it's impressive that it's really built into the way they work. So there you go. Thank you so much for listening to episode 248 of the Thoughtful Travel podcast, and I hope you have enjoyed hearing about some of the different ways we can study in other countries. A big thanks to all my guests. Now, they're in fact all authors today, so I want to mention their websites and their most recent books as well. So first of all, Caitlin Jane is at caitlinjane.com, and her book is about traveling with kids. It's called Passports and Pacifiers: Traveling the World One Tantrum at a Time. I then chatted with Helena Fox. You can find her at helenafoxauthor.com. And she has a recent young adult fiction book novel, How It Feels to Float. I read it. It's amazing. And last but very definitely not least, I had the pleasure of chatting with Annie Daly. And you can find more about Annie at anniedaly.com. And she has a book out recently called Destination Wellness. I read this one too. It's incredible. It's basically a compilation of her experiences with wellness kinds of cultures in different places. The subtitle is Global Secrets for Better Living Wherever You Are. And she looked at different cultures like Japan. So, of course, I loved it. Norway, Hawaii, India, Brazil, to name a few. And, yeah, it was just a really interesting combination of cultural differences and different ideas to do with wellness. So it was, yeah, really worth a read. Now, the other thing in the show notes will be a link to episode 233, which is also about studying abroad. So if you've enjoyed this, you might like to listen to that one as well. There will also be links to our Facebook and LinkedIn groups. In Facebook, just search for Thoughtful Travelers, and at LinkedIn, you can search for it, or you can also just use this short link, which is notaballerina.com/LinkedIn. All of this stuff will be in the show notes, and for this episode, the show notes are at notaballerina.com/248. As always, thank you so much for listening. This has been another episode of the Thoughtful Travel Podcast. Show notes and other information are at notaballerina.com/podcast. Join me again soon for another chat about why we travel. Bye for now.